Well, hello, everybody. I'm John Rabin. Thanks for joining me again. It's Still Sober with John Rabin. You see the link. I don't know why I have to say it. Thanks. Thanks for being here. If you're a sober person, hope you're staying sober. If you're not a sober person, hope you're staying sane. I am going to add a couple things today. Those of you who've been following my treatments, preventative treatments, the BCG treatments are going well for fighting the tumor in my bladder, or to keep it from coming back. If you're new to this podcast, and first of all, it's not a podcast; it's a audio diary of how things are going with sobriety, but also with just, you know, in general. And if you're wondering, hey, how do you get the tumor in your bladder? Smoking cigarettes for 20 plus years. That's how you do it. So if that's something that interests you, try smoking. You may not have seen that warning on the pack. Warning, you may get a form of cancer that is only deadly if you ignore it, but is expensive. I haven't seen that on, didn't see that on a Marlboro pack, but apparently that's a thing. Anyway, things are going, those are going all right. It definitely, there are the side effects, the fatigue, as I mentioned last week, that is definitely real. I'm absolutely getting the fatigue. It's like the next day fatigue hits me. And then it hits you for about, then it stops like about 4:30, and it's like, oh great, I have energy and only an hour more to do all the work that I should be doing. So it's more frustrating than anything. I do this on occasion because this is not productive. It's kind of mocking, and it's not necessarily a positive or productive thing, but I do it because it's, I find it funny. And that is when the natural inclination, when you become a sober person, is to like, I'm going to change my life. You know what? I've done some things. And, you know, I've gone from being kind of a piece of shit to slightly less of a piece of shit, but a functional member of society. I am a reformed piece of shit, if you will. And you're like, other people, I bet I could help others. Now, some people, when they want to help others, they get into service. Maybe they become more active in their church. Maybe they become more active in the 12-step program. You know, they become a sponsor. Some of it's for service. A lot of it, though, doing sponsorship is, the idea is it actually helps you. You do it for self, like you do anything for selfish reasons, because it makes you feel better or because it helps you. It's the reason I do this, this recording once a week, because this is my meeting. This is what I do, knowing very well that, you know, that nobody could be listening, or that less people that I would like are listening, even though it's like the fact that anybody's listening still is like, really? Damn. After this many years, you guys are all right. So, but some people like, or they go to get their, you know, they go back to school, they start getting a degree in like counseling and like drug counseling, 'cause they want to help others. Right. But some people get the idea And I know, and I get it, because I get it too. Sometimes I think, maybe I could do some kind of guru sobriety bullshit and turn it into easy money. Yeah. I mean, it's like anything else. You sit there like, hey, how could I market myself? Is this my ticket to something bigger? And so what happens is you get a lot of people who, yeah, it's kind of this, you know, I'm a motivational speaker. Do I speak on my success? Or, you know, I'm going to tell you how it is and, you know, help you get your life together. Like I got my life together, you know, so-and-so is, you know, he's been sober for over 3 years and he's going to share his wisdom with you. 3 years? Wow. Like, and so what happens is that these guys write books or throw a book together. If they've got any kind of dedication, they do that. But so a lot of them just start like, you know, hey, you know, I'd love to be a guest on your podcast and all this other stuff. But the deal is that I have rarely had anybody contact me directly and be like, hey, I listened to your podcast, and like send me like a real message and be like, hey, you know what? I'd like to be a guest on your podcast and talk about my story. I've never had that. What I get instead is these guys get some kind of fly-by-night marketing email spam company. And it's a company, and I use quotations. It's another person trying to get rich quick. And that's what I'm going to actually be talking about here. This is I got an email, and this is not so much to poke fun at the guy the guy himself, whose name is Daryl Dittmer, but it's about the email promoting him. Now the guy, Daryl Dittmer, his bio is weird because I'll read the bio. So Daryl Dittmer, after a humble and often tumultuous beginning to his life, what? Daryl Dittmer has worked relentlessly on himself for almost 40 years. Having hailed from a blue-collar family and upbringing, work ethic was instilled early and often. Daryl was put to work as a farmhand on the early age at $1.50 an hour per hour and learned the immense value of hard work and long days. Since those days, Daryl has been a carpenter, sales professional, business owner, builder, landlord, real estate investor, and consultant. Now we're able to add author to that list. Oh, good. Daryl feels very fortunate to have had mentors assist him with his life's journey and wants nothing more than to pass on what was so graciously given to him. He considers it to an honor to be in a position to do that. Blah, blah, blah. And his books, he has two books, one coming out, one that's out. The one that's out is called When I Stop Fighting: The Unexpected Joy of Getting My Head Out of My Ass. Huh. Right? Let's see. And then, just like water seeks its own level, so does everything else, including idiots. I was one of those at that point in my life. That's a horrible quote, because there's no context. It's just weird. But his new book is the second installment in the Getting Your Head Out of Your Ass series. Instead of When I Stop Fighting, it's called When You Stop Fighting. And the sub headline is, Now Let's Work on Getting Your Head Out of Your Ass. All right. I like the, and then he said, you know, like the email sent to me by this company, and it's one guy, Saeed, who's the founder and CEO of BizV Assist. That's catchy and absolutely makes a lot of sense, I guess. BizV Assist. Here's the email he sent to me. Dear John, I hope you are doing well. I am. I came across your podcast channel and was blown away by the incredible work you are doing. Clearly not listening to this. I know immediately that he hasn't. No. Nobody is blown away by the work that I am doing. I'm not. My biggest fans are not. They're like, hey, it's fine. You can't listen to 30 minutes of this and go, I am blown away by the amount of shit talking that he does in 27 minutes. It's crazy. Anyway, I am reaching out today to suggest Daryl Dittmer as a potential guest for your podcast. Ooh, he'll be the first guest I've ever had in 6 years. And then he has all the, and then he basically copies and pastes that bio that I just started to read and got tired of reading. He copies all of that onto there. And it's like, Daryl can bring valuable insights to your podcast on a variety of topics, including sobriety, self-improvement, facing life's challenges, his book, Recovery from Addiction, and in parentheses, S. So addiction. What defines addiction? Moving your life forward, intentional living, disciplines and principles for a well-rounded, successful life, and then successful living, which is the same as the thing before. And then Saeed emails me a week later. I hope this email finds you well. Still well. I wanted to follow up on my previous messages. Messages? There's one. Anyway. Regarding the possibility of having Daryl Dittmer as a guest on your podcast. I understand that your schedule is likely hectic. Not really. I just don't give a shit. But I believe Daryl's insights would be a valuable addition to your show. Do you? Saeed, you haven't listened to my show. There's a lot of things. I don't disagree here. I think that his insights would be valuable. I think that just about anybody's insights would be a valuable addition to this. I just don't do it because that's not what this is. I've seen, because on Daryl's website, by the way, on his media kit, he's got links to other podcasts that he's done, and I've clicked on them and kind of looked. They're terrible. Like, I talk shit about myself and about like, hey, I know this thing sucks. Thanks for listening to me. And it's kind of tongue in cheek. I don't think highly of my work because I don't put a lot of effort into it. I just do it once a week and I don't stop. I never don't do it. And I just talk because it just seems the real thing to do is just like, let's just talk it out. Let's just talk for a while. And it's either going to be good or it's not. I'm not going to do a whole lot of prep. I'm not putting on a show here. I'm da 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 da. You know, I'm not doing the picture me with the top hat, the cane, like the cartoon. Yeah. So anyway, yeah, it's, I don't doubt that. The thing that I don't understand about Daryl here is his bio does not say, it's just kind of a, he's had a decent life. He's like, hey, you know, I've worked hard and I've just kept going the whole time. Great. All right. How inspirational, how you've just slowly gotten better over time. Evolved like a person. But there's some interview questions interview questions, suggestions in the media kit, should I have Daryl on? What is the fight referred to in the title of your book? How do addictions stop us from moving forward in life? How? Money. Self-destruction. How does self-destruction, let me ask you a question, Daryl. How does self-destruction hinder you from self-construction? Oh, I love this question. How would you define getting your head out of your ass? Yeah. Yes, please explain. Define taking your head out of your ass. Can you explain it to other people? What can we expect as we recover from addiction and improve ourselves? How much success are we allowed to have? That's a question. How do you think it's different getting sober these days versus in 1985? Hang on a minute. You've been sober 40 years? 40 years. Damn. And you're just now writing a book? And I don't know. I can tell you this. How do you think it's different getting sober these days versus in 1985? I don't think he would know. Because you're not getting sober this year. It's a world of fucking difference versus 85. I'm guessing getting sober in 85 is quit doing the cocaine. You're not distracted by any, you can do it quietly. There's no internet. There's no iPhones with people taking videos of you doing dumb shit. I don't know. No social media. Drinking and driving wasn't really all that illegal in 1985. All right. Sorry. I'm getting, do you have any other books planned? Yeah. Getting their head out of their ass. Book 4. Getting one's head out of one's ass. Can we do all the different pronouns? Sorry. All right. Have I really been doing this for 17 minutes? I have. I've been making fun of Daryl for 17 minutes. More Saeed and his horseshit promotion. Daryl paid money for that, by the way. It's probably only like 1995 or something. It was probably like a one-time payment. And that company, what was the company? BizVAssist.com. Let's look at that. I'm going to look. Sorry. BizVAssist.com. I didn't pull up shit. Oh, there it is. Your virtual assistants. Oh, this seems like a hacker. All right. I'm not messing with that bullshit. Anyway, Jesus Christ. That's my thing, is that if somebody, I may not say yes, but I would consider interviewing somebody who actually liked the show and wanted to talk about their sobriety. I might consider it. The hindrance would be that I don't know how to fucking do that. Like we'd have to do it in, like, I don't know if I could record on Zoom. That's like one step in technology that I haven't grasped yet. I don't have that yet, but anyway. You know, this brings up a thing, though, because naturally, people that get in recovery, that become sober, normally become better. I mean, that just makes sense, right? It just makes sense because when you're self-destructing, I mean, you're not going to be at your best. Rarely, I think that if you're having a problem with alcohol or you're having a problem with drugs, let's say you're a huge cokehead, and you go through recovery. Maybe you get into rehab. Maybe you do it through 12-step. You get off of cocaine. Rarely are you going to stop doing cocaine for 90 days and get worse. You're probably not going to become more of a talkative dick than when you were strung out on coke. That's just natural. It would be interesting, though. Wouldn't it be interesting, though, if, like, you get sober, like you're a fun-loving drunk, but you're self-destructing. I mean, it's killing you. You got to get off the booze. You're just everything's been destroyed, but you get off the booze. You sober up, you get your life together, and then you become a worse person. Like, suddenly you become a greedy prick because you can become real successful and you start fucking people over. That's the thing, is that I imagine there's got to be some people like that. That, you know, they get their life together and then immediately become, I mean, that's the whole thing, is you get people who get sober and they start judging everybody else around them. Like, well, look at all these fucks have alcohol and drug problems. All these people need to get their shit together like I did. You get a big head of yourself. So I don't know. That's the whole, I mean, that's where that, you know, I don't think it's been said enough, is that just because you become sober doesn't mean that you're a good person. You don't become a better person just because you're not getting fucked up. I mean, typically you're going to get a little bit, but I mean, that's why there's predators in 12-step. That's why you try not to, that's why they tell you not to start dating anybody in the first year of sobriety. Not only because you can't deal with it, it's harder to deal with, but also you don't have the judgment to see the wolves in the room, the predators. I mean, not even sexual predator, like emotional, like just predators, the ones that'll feed off you like humans do. So I think my thing, that's my thing about these kind of promotions. These promotional emails get to me. It just kind of irritates me. And I get it, because I, like I said, I've had the thought too, is like, how can I, you know, is there a way I could somehow profit off of, you know, me bettering myself or, you know, becoming sober, that, you know, being sober this long, you know, 11 plus years. How can I monetize this? But I always end up coming back to, it's a bad taste in my mouth. And it leaves a bad taste in my mouth when I see that stuff. I see the, you know, people trying to, you know, it's like, hey, suddenly I'm a motivational speaker. Except that, you know, you got to have a good story. You can't just be like, I started off down here like everybody did, and then I slowly built up and became successful over the years through ups and downs. Not so many downs, mainly ups, kind of middles. Just, you know, boring life over 40 years and, hey, turned into something because of hard work. And here's my book to tell you how hard work will put you through. I'm going to tell you how to, you know, live like I did, that worked for me in the 80s. You can use it now. No, you can't. It's a different world. I mean, I believe, yes, I do believe that doing your best is a good thing. I do believe that. It is weird to me that people that are older than me, I'm old, I'm already kind of judgy, and I fight that. you know, trying to tell anybody, you know, you could do it like I did. I don't think you can. I think it's different. It's not worse. It's not better. It's just different. Life's different now than it was in the 90s and the 80s. That's why I'm so nostalgic for it. I like the 90s, but it's different. It's a different time. And I also understand why, because that is the thing. You naturally, like I said, you naturally do get better when you're not fucked up. You're going to become kind of a better person, because we all instinctively have our moral code. And if you're not distorting your reality, you're going to drift back to that moral code. And I like things that present me with ethics, like a reminder of ethics, not so much moral codes, not morality. I don't like getting morality preached to me. I'm more of a let's talk about ethics versus morality kind of a dude. What I mean by that is, for example, 12-step, a lot of people get turned off of 12-step because, you know, you get people that repeat the lines, the different sayings in there. It comes off just kind of moral, you know, talking about God and just, you know, doing this and doing that. And I like a more ethical approach. That's why I like the Four Agreements, because I always like any kind of life game plan that doesn't preach to you. I jokingly said, if you're a hitman, could a hitman follow the principles? And if so, that means that it's not being morally oppressive. It's just giving you, a code of ethics. Like, and that's what the Four Agreements are. It's be impeccable with your word. Don't be a lying son, a gossiping son of a bitch. Don't take anything personally. Don't make assumptions. That's a big one. And always do your best. And all of those, none of those are preachy to you about, like, you know, thou shalt not covet thy, you know, monkey. It's not the thou, thy, thou, thus. It's just, you know, it's like, hey, don't make assumptions. Don't take things personally, because it's not about you. Don't be a gossipy piece of shit, and always do your best. Try. God damn it. Try. You know, it's pretty good. So I don't know. What's my point? My point is, I'm not necessarily opposed to people trying to get their bag, but when people are obviously trying to sell you their book, or sell you their, you know, motivational speech, or do advertising, it's just not genuine. It just comes off, you're just kind of a fucking salesperson now. Your words are kind of hollow, and there's no, yeah, it's just not, I don't know. It just doesn't, it's not genuine. I don't trust you. And there's just something about having integrity, man. You know? What little integrity that you could have. It just rings hollow. And I like it. I like integrity. We're in short supply of it right now. Wouldn't you agree? Anyway, I've rambled along enough and made fun of Daryl too much. more Shahid than Daryl, but hey, don't email me. Or do. You know, I guess I gave him free promotion. Go check out his book. Gzz. Something about heads and asses. Heads and ass. Check out his book, Head in My Ass. A Daryl Dittmer story. StillSoberPod@gmail.com for any questions or comments that are positive to neutral. Woo! Oh, I had fun this week. All right, we'll see you next week. All right, later. Disconnect the telephone line.